morning, we are going to open our service with the Lord's Prayer. I'll have it right up here on the screen. Would you please join me in reciting the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our call to worship is found in Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. With that said, we are going to open our service with our first hymn. It's the doxology, number 572. The words will be right up here on the screen. We're going to sing 572, followed by hymn number 1, Holy, Holy, Holy. So if you could stand, would you please do so? And we'll have the words right up here on the screen.
Bear the weaknesses of those without strength and not just please ourselves. Each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. For even Christ did not please himself. But as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and encouragement of Scripture, we might have hope. And may God bless the reading.
I guess you all know that there are a lot of people in our church family that have really going through so many struggles and trials and tribulations, whether it be physical, emotional, with families. You know who you are. But you have to know that God is always with you. And I was asked to actually sing this song. James 1:2-4. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything.
Knowing that for every step you were with.
us make mistakes. And as we go through life, we stumble, we fall, we trip, we make lots of messes. And the question I have for you this morning is not so much how do you deal with your own mistakes, your own sins, your own errors, but how do we handle the sins of others? That's a very difficult hurdle when we go through life and we're dealing with other people's mistakes. We find that in the book of Genesis here, Noah, who has been pretty much a sterling character from the beginning on up to this moment of the flood, is leading almost a spotless life. We know he's not sinless, but he walks with God. It tells us he walks with God. He has a relationship with God, and God finds him righteous in his sight because he's walking by faith, and he obeys God step by step, builds the ark, gets through the judgment. Everything God says, Noah follows through. And then we come to Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 onward, and we think, oh my, Noah stumbles. And we see two responses here to Noah's mistake, his error, his sin. And we have much to glean, much to learn, because it will truly help us in our relationships as we discover how God desires for us to respond when other people err. So let's take a look here, Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 23. Lots of practical things. Genesis 9, 18 through 23, it says this. Now the sons of Noah who came out of the ark were Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah, and from these the whole earth was populated. Then Noah began farming and planted a vineyard. He drank of the wine and became drunk and uncovered himself inside his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brothers outside. But Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it upon both their shoulders, and walked backward and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were turned away so that they did not see their father's nakedness. And we will stop right there. There is an awful lot in this passage. It is a very controversial piece of scripture. Lots of commentaries go in a variety of directions. I want to put a caveat out there before I go any further that if you do any reading and research on this, you're going to see a plethora of views and interpretations. And I believe, really, when you get down to it, a very simple approach would be the best bet because people go in places they really don't need to on this particular topic. But let's take a look. We have an action, and then we have a reaction. And then, of course, there's some application we could glean. We have the action here. We are on the eve of a victory. Noah and his sons, they have survived. They are repopulating. They are following God's commands. They're doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing in terms of spreading out and once again having dominion, having stewardship over the creation. And Noah is a man of the soil, as some translations might say, and he goes out and he does exactly what he's supposed to do, and he plants himself a garden and a vineyard and he grows some grapes, and we find out that he ends up getting drunk. And one of the things this brings, it raises all sorts of issues, and that is wine in Scripture. And we find that the Bible speaks of wine. It's all over the entire Bible. And there's nothing condemned in terms of somebody having a glass of wine or drinking some wine. We see that Jesus turned water into wine. So that happened at the Feast of Canaan. Paul tells Timothy that it's okay to have a little wine rather than just drinking water because of his stomach ailments. He saw it as a medicinal issue. So we find that it's permissible, but the issue here is excess. It's drunkenness. That's the problem. And this is an issue that can transcend all sorts of various things that we do in the course of our lives. It doesn't just have to apply to wine. It could be food. We're supposed to eat, obviously, and all of God's people should be saying amen at this moment. But gluttony is condemned. We're supposed to sleep and get some rest, but laziness and too much sleep is also condemned. And the book of Ecclesiastes makes it clear that all these extremes are to be avoided. And what we find here is that drunkenness is clearly condemned in the Bible. In fact, one of the reasons why it is because it's what it leads to. Habakkuk explains this, Habakkuk 2:15. Woe to you who make your neighbors drink, who mix in your venom even to make them drunk so that as to look on their nakedness. This was a problem. And Ephesians 5, 15 through 18 says this, therefore be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time. Why? Because the days are evil. So then do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. But be filled, what? With the Spirit. And the reason why intoxication becomes a problem is because it lowers our spiritual guard. When we lose control, which is exactly what drunkenness will bring us to, we now become vulnerable on a variety of levels. And we see that vulnerability here with Noah. It happens a few chapters later with Lot and his daughters. They get Lot drunk and all sorts of crazy things happen after that. David gets Uriah the Hittite drunk because he wants him to go and be with his wife instead of out with the army. So what we find here is that there's a major problem with intoxication, because when we are in that state of inebriation, that leads to all sorts of other problems. Plus, it can be highly addictive, and that's another issue. If you destroy the temple, the body, which we have, God tells us we have to be stewards of it, and He will destroy us. So we have an obligation to take care of ourselves, but we also find here that there is this notion of excess. And Noah, sadly, steps over the line. He is passed out in his tent, and he doesn't have anything on. He's exposed. And that's another level of problem here. It wasn't just the fact that Noah was struggling with some insobriety here, but now he's exposed himself. And in the ancient world especially, that was a major taboo. The notion of being clothed, the idea of having a garment over your body, was extremely important. It still is today, especially when you wake up in the middle of June and it's like 45 degrees out. I mean, I'm ready to start the wood stove this morning. I couldn't believe it. I got up this morning. I'm like, I'm shivering when I'm walking my dog, and I've got an extra shirt on. And but the idea here of clothing is very important. What happened in the Garden of Eden? Adam and Eve sinned. What was one of the first reactions that we see in the garden in response to their fall? To be clothed, to cover. There's shame. And because of that, we see this motif of clothing, no pun intended here, but literally woven through the fabric of the Bible. And from Genesis to the end of Revelation, we have this theme of clothing and being clothed literally as well as spiritually. It's not just a literal piece, it's a metaphorical piece as well. And the idea of having clothing is critical because it is to cover that which has been tainted. And all throughout the Bible, Revelation will mention we're to be, we get what? Robes in heaven, white robes. Literal and symbolic of something that is going to cover the nakedness, to remove the humiliation. When parts of the body, even a little bit, are uncovered in the Bible, that communicates a message. We see, you've heard of the term, you know, to bear arms. Well, that doesn't, you know, start with, you know, the Second Amendment here in the United States. That stems back to the ancient Semitic culture. When you wanted to start a fight with somebody, you'd come by, and you'd have your robe, and you'd roll up your sleeve, and you'd let them take a look at a bare arm. And that meant you were going to be belligerent. You were ready to put up your dukes, have it out. So we find here that clothing is critical, and it removes the shame. So what was happening here with Noah is that even though he is a godly man, a righteous man, he is now humiliated himself, and he's also fallen. And what we see really is that even after the flood, after the judgment, people continue to sin. Romans 7 says it quite well. What I don't want to do, I do. And what I do, I don't want to do. And there's this wrestling match that's going to continue until the end of the age. Point number one, very simple, is this. Godly people continue to fall. The best of the best in the Bible continue to sin. Moses, David, all of them, Peter, John, the entire cast of characters we see in the scriptures, the best of the best, are going to make mistakes. And Noah's one of them. Number two, what's the reaction? We have Ham, and then we have Shem and Japheth. It seems like a very minor event, but it actually sets the stage. This is a seminal turning point in the scriptures that sets the stage for how the nation of Israel is actually going to emerge ultimately. What does Ham do? He sins against his father. Three major mistakes are made in that tent. First off, Ham looked upon his father. I'm not going to expand any further in terms of the crazy interpretations of what that means, but he gazed at him for a moment. And he invaded his privacy and his propriety. The second thing Ham did was he went out and he told with a sense of delight the brothers what dad was like in the tent. He looks down, he sees them, and he goes out and he gabs about it a little bit. He showed disdain and a lack of respect. And finally, Ham failed to intervene. I want you to take a look with me at a passage from James. James 4:17. Therefore, to one who knows the right thing to do and doesn't do it, to him it is sin. This is a sin of omission. When we fail to act and it's in our power to do something. So what we find here with Ham is three things are taking place. One, he looked, two, he told, and three, he just didn't do anything. And because of that, he has made a major offense and dishonored his father in the condition he is in. That was his reaction to the situation. Shem and Japheth do just the opposite. They find out about the situation, and first off, what do? They look the other way. They actually walk in backwards. If you were to look at the situation literally, the two brothers walk in backwards, looking the other way so that they would not shame or dishonor or humiliate their dad. They do so, they bring his robe and they cover him and they remove that shame from him. And that was their response to their father's mistake. We really have lots to take away with this. There's a tremendous application. The question here is, am I my brother's keeper? And the answer is, you betcha you are. Each one of us has this responsibility. When somebody sins, somebody makes a mistake, there's one of two paths we could be taking. The ungodly will alienate. The ungodly will humiliate. The ungodly will exploit. I was listening to a sermon not too long ago, and they were quoting this old minister from Texas. And he said in front of his congregation one day, the most offensive word in the English language is they. They're the ones. Not us. Them. Me. Pointing the finger, pushing and alienating. I want you to look at this analogy. Think about it for a moment, especially within the body of Christ. You're out on a boat. I'm not much of a boat person. My feet like solid ground. They really do. I get motion sickness. That's the problem. But some of you like to boat. Some of you like to get out there. You have canoes. You have kayaks. You have rowboats, sailboats, motorboats. You're out on the lake, okay? I want you're in the boat, okay? I want you to picture the boat. You're there. You got your feet on there. Maybe you're fishing. Maybe you're just enjoying the sights. Whatever the case may be, you're in a boat. What happens if that boat starts to spring a leak? Doesn't matter where it is. You got a problem. It could be in the front of the boat. It could be in the back of the boat. It could be on the side of the boat. It could be a crack in the boat. It could be a hole in the boat. Doesn't matter where the leak is. You're in the boat. And you're in trouble because that boat is starting to sink. And this is what we find in the body of Christ. When one part of the body suffers, we all suffer. When one part of the body is struggling, we're all sinking because we are a body. And one part can't say to the other part, I don't need you. I could alienate myself from you. I could cut myself off from you. That's not love. That's not what the scriptures teach. And what ends up happening is when somebody makes a mistake around us, what we do is we point to them or they, pull ourselves back. And in reality, what we're doing is we're hurting everybody in the whole process. That is what Ham does. That, sadly, is what a lot of people do. And because of that, we become weak and we stumble along because we don't know how to handle other people's mistakes. The godly, rather than alienating, will look to ways or for ways to alleviate. They will look to alleviate. Galatians 6, 1 and 2 explains how. Brethren, if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself so that you too will not be tempted. Bear one another's burdens and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. I'm going to go back up here. If anyone is caught, literally struggling, having a tough time, this isn't just an oops, this isn't just you accidentally were driving down the road and you said the wrong word when somebody came flying by you, going a little bit too fast. We're talking about a habit here, a sin. If somebody is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, you who see this, you who are around, you have what? An obligation. And here's the word to restore. This is a medical term in Greek. It's the idea of taking two bones that have been broken and mending them and putting them back together again. To bring about a sense of restoration, to do so with gentleness. But also to watch out so that you are not tempted. And it tells us here what? Bear one another's burden. Carry the load. Help one another. And then you will fulfill the law of Christ. That's what a church is called to do. We don't sit in the boat and say, hey, there's a hole over there. We find ways to patch it. We find ways to fix it. I want to give you five simple things that can be done to bear the burden. Number one, pray. We can be praying for one another. We need to be praying for one another. You see somebody struggling, you see somebody with a hard time, it's not a them and us issue. We're all part of this team. I actually believe it would be wonderful if every church could form some sort of a competitive team where we're either playing softball or volleyball or something, wherever, it doesn't matter who you are, whether you're the youngest and the oldest in the church, we're just out there doing some sort of a team sport on a regular basis. You know what that would do? When you're doing team sports, you learn that when the person out in left field doesn't do their job, it affects everybody. When the person who is actually just coaching on the sideline doesn't do their job or his job, then the team suffers. When you play team sports, you understand every person on that field, every play, every step, every pitch, everything is critical. It's all important as a team. So we need to pray for this team fervently, interceding for one another. We need to try to be a good example. That's the second thing we could be doing. People need to see good sermons, not just hear them, they need to see them in you. They need to see what it looks like to live out a godly life. It's hard to tell somebody who's got a mouth issue and they're swearing and cussing and all over the place to clean up your mouth when you're dropping the you-know-what bomb every few minutes. It's called hypocrisy. So we need to set forth an example. Pray like crazy. Try to be the best example we can be. We should warn people. We're called to warn people. It says warn a divisive person once, warn them again. We need to be willing to step up and say, look, if you continue on that path, you're going to get hurt. You keep on drinking like a fish, you're going to get hurt. You keep up with this attitude, you're going to hurt more people around you. It's not like we're trying to condemn. We're not called to judge. We're not called to, alienate people. We're not called to ignore or enable. But we're called to speak up and speak out. Pray. Exemplify. Warn. Teach. Point folk to the scriptures. You're having a hard time with your finances? The Bible has lots to tell us about the finances. Let's take a look. There's scriptures here that speak to your need and your struggle. We could teach others. And then finally, we could encourage. You can do this with God's grace. You could do this by virtue of the Spirit. You could do this when you put into practice that which God learns and you share testimonies. And these are the things: praying, exemplifying, warning, teaching, encouraging. That's what it means to bear the burden with one another. It's not to ignore. It's not to condemn. It's not to judge. It's not to alienate. It's not to ostracize. But this is what we are called to do. The godly person will help alleviate the load, whereas the ungodly will alienate. I want to give you a quick picture of what this looks like, and we'll wrap it up. I knew of a family many years ago. They were struggling. I mean, they were really having a hard time financially. They're going through life paycheck to paycheck, having a tough time just putting clothes on the kids' backs. It was just a rough road for them for many, many years. They come into a little bit of money, about $10,000. This was an old story. This is back in like the 70s. So $10,000 back then was 50, 60, maybe 100,000 today. It was a lot of money for them at the time. They come into this money. A family member had passed away, and they received a bit of an inheritance. So they're excited. They got some relief now. Well, the father goes out a few weeks later, and he takes that $10,000 and he invests it in a losing proposition. The scripture says it's not good to have zeal without knowledge, nor to be hasty in the midst of the way. And this guy had too much zeal and he had no knowledge and he was hasty and he really missed the way and he lost the money. He's absolutely devastated. He finds out that that break that they were looking for just melted away because of his mistake. He's sitting in the kitchen, his head in his hands. He's crushed. He feels horrible. His wife comes home and sees her husband there, gently weeping. She asks him what happened. He explains the story. And she sat down next to him and said, "I still love you. I still respect you. I still trust your judgment. We make mistakes, and God will provide. Let's move forward from here." At that juncture, that woman could have crushed her husband, but instead, she helped carry the load. She helped bear the weight. She helped to encourage him down the road. That is what we need to do. We're not called to ignore. We're not called to enable. We're called to bear, and thus fulfill the law of love. So when people make mistakes around you, and they're going to, hang out with me for more than 15 minutes and I will give you an opportunity to put this into practice. And when that happens, bear in mind, you and I are our brother's keepers. And we have a call, we have a duty, we have an obligation. We will either alienate or we will alleviate the burden that all of us carry because we're still struggling with this thing called sin. Let's pray.